Hello, thanks for coming. I'm Jesse Rothstein. I'm co-founder and CTO at ExtraHop. Prior to that, I was lead architect at F5 Networks many, many, many years ago. But what you can see is that for almost 20 years, I've been building intelligent network equipment. A little later, we'll be joined by my co-speaker, Josh Northrup, and Josh is manager at Fiserv of network monitoring and automation. So today we're going to talk a little bit about network security, and in particular, how increasing encryption really poses challenges for the enterprise in this area. New standards like TLS 1.3 and DNS over HTTPS, which try, and I think in many ways succeed, in improving personal privacy and limiting mass surveillance, greatly reduce visibility for cybersecurity. Is this an unintended consequence? Is privacy, personal privacy really at odds with enterprise security? I grapple with these issues myself. I'm going to try to stay away from the larger privacy debate and really talk more about current trends and some real world mitigations. So the vast majority of all traffic on the internet is encrypted. It took us 20 years to get to about 40% encrypted. We jumped another 40% plus in just the last 4 years alone. This comes from Google Chrome telemetry. Data center and public cloud traffic is a little harder to gauge, but my personal experience puts it at somewhere between 50% and completely encrypted. And of course, campus environments are probably a little bit less than that. Across all theaters, we are undeniably on our way to 100% encryption. And of course, TLS 1.3 is here. After about 4 years and 28 drafts, TLS 1.3 was approved in March of 2018. About 5 months later, RFC 8446 was published. And here we are another year and a half later, and it is widely supported and deployed, with the lone and very notable exception of Windows 10. Version 1909, as of November, is the latest version, and it remains only experimental support and off by default. Yet we anticipate that will come at some point in the not so distant future. TLS 1.3 itself actually includes major changes that greatly improve the security of the protocol. Personally, and I don't think I'm alone here, I think it should be called TLS 2.0 when you look at the number of changes compared to previous versions of TLS. It removed all of the legacy and obsolete crypto, ciphers like RC4 and triple DES, hashes like SHA-1 and MD5. There's no more export-grade encryption, which led to downgrade attacks like Freak and Logjam. There's no more CBC encryption, which was vulnerable to attacks like Beast and Poodle. Removed a bunch of options like compression that was vulnerable to the crime attacks. Renegotiation itself, which was also susceptible to splicing and triple handshakes, was decomposed into two separate messages, the key update and the certificate request operations. And I feel a little bad saying this at the RSA conference, but there are no more RSA key exchanges. Those are gone because they were susceptible to just a variety of Blickenbacher attacks like Drown and Robot. But most important for this discussion, the handshake itself is a lot more encrypted. Everything after the server hello is encrypted. And all of the remaining supported cipher suites are cipher suites with perfect forward secrecy, or PFS. Now, when we look at the TLS handshake at a high level, and this is a TLS 1.2 handshake, it really accomplishes three things. First, the handshake authenticates the participants, typically just the server, but you can have client authentication as well using client certificates and mutual TLS. Second, we agree upon a cipher suite, and finally, the participants need to derive a session key. Now, in TLS 1.2, that took two complete round trips, back and forth, back and forth. The client advertises a list of supported ciphers, and then the server picks one, and then we go on to negotiate the cipher suite and the keys. I want to point out here that the certificate itself is sent in the clear, so it's something that we can observe with network monitoring as a passive participant. Now with TLS 1.3, the handshakes themselves are much faster. A complete round trip was saved, really with the optimization of just optimistically assuming that the server is going to support the cipher suite that the client offers, allowing the client to, you know, include that initial key share. So it saves a complete round trip time, which benefits billions of users on the internet. And there's also a zero RTT mode, which is part of the pre-share key using something called early data. This came from QUIC, which is the protocol from Google on which much of TLS 1.3 is based. And we can only assume that the zero RTT mode is for serving faster ads and page tracking. It doesn't. That's what we have to assume. It does not have the same forward secrecy guarantees across sessions and is subject to some replay attacks. But again, faster ads and page tracking, I guess, is a good thing. And then, just to reiterate the point, in TLS 1.3, the server certificate is fully encrypted since that occurs after the client hello. Now, taking a step back, why am I talking about all of this encryption? Why am I talking about TLS 1.3? I'm talking about this because while encryption is great for privacy and security, it limits network visibility. And I am a huge fan of network visibility. I've dedicated the last dozen years of my life to improving network visibility. And the reason I believe in it so much is that the network itself is one of the three fundamental sources of data that we have in cybersecurity and SecOps with which to derive intelligence. We can look at log files or machine data, and we can put that in a SIM. We can instrument our endpoints, but we can look at the network as well. And I always tell organizations, this is not the tyranny of the or, this is the genius of the and. We should be doing all three. Now, my personal bias, of course, is that network is the best because it has these great properties that the other sources of data don't have. The network itself is as close to ground truth as you can possibly get. If you see it happen on the network, you know that it happened. It is extremely difficult to tamper with, and it's almost impossible to turn off, certainly without anyone noticing. So that makes the network extremely valuable for cybersecurity. And of course, not everything logs information that you can collect, and not everything can be instrumented with an endpoint agent. Now, when we think about network detection and network visibility, often in the vernacular, we talk about north-south versus east-west orientation. And I think this is a useful model. The north-south orientation is at the internet gateway, and the east-west corridor is in the environment you control. It can be a campus environment, it can be a data center environment, it can be a cloud environment. Now, the reason that network detection works is because there are a million ways to be compromised. There are a million ways, well, with the modern attack surface, for an intrusion to occur. But there are relatively few post-breach behaviors and indicators of compromise that we can observe that every attacker is going to follow after that initial compromise. Some of those occur at that north-south corridor, you know, the initial access, command and control, the data exfiltration itself has to go somewhere. And then many of them occur in the east-west corridor. That's where we'll see some amount of lateral movement. That's where we'll see staging and data collection and such. Now, not long ago, most traffic was unencrypted. In fact, HTTPS used to just be used for your login screens, for your password, and when inputting a credit card. And everything else was plain text. In some ways, this was kind of the heyday of network intrusion detection systems because they could inspect the payload, they could perform file carving, you could record as many packets as you want for forensics. And on a personal note, I always think about this in terms of web content caches as well. You know, every time I'm on an airplane with really slow Wi-Fi, I kind of yearn for the day that everybody could share a content cache and I wouldn't have to wait for everybody's individual, Facebook images and everything else to be downloaded. So web caches worked really well as well. But it's really been a long time now that we've had HTTPS and an increasing amount of HTTPS, maybe even HTTPS everywhere. And of course, with HTTPS, we can no longer observe the URI, the host header, or the payload when we're doing network level analysis. But we don't need to read the letter in order to know where it's going. In fact, we have a lot of good information that we can see on the wire. We can see the DNS request and the hostname resolution. We can see the SNI, the server name indication, which also tells us where the host is going. From the DNS information, we can enforce blacklists, look at DNS reputation scores. We can even perform some sort of blocking. We can detect things like DGAs, domain generation algorithms that are used by malware. There are a lot of really good detections that we can use that we can perform at the DNS level. Similarly, with SNI, there are a lot of good detections we can enforce when we look at, you know, where is this traffic at least advertised that it's going. Now, it's worth mentioning that SNI itself is meant for virtual hosting. So if you ever have a common server or a common load balancer or a proxy that needs to serve up multiple sites, the SNI extension was introduced so that the server itself or the proxy or the load balancer would know which certificate to offer up. So that's actually a required extension in certain deployments. And then finally, in this model, we do have the certificate, and there's all sorts of great information in the certificate itself. We can see the server name, we can see the organization, we can see the purported location. And then from a detection perspective, we can detect expiring certificates, we can detect self-signed certificates, which in some cases might not be authorized according to the policy or certainly might be unusual. We can detect let's encrypt certificates. We can detect weak crypto. Lots of great detections that we can perform when we have access to that network, that certificate on the network. Now with TLS 1.2, there's a recent occurrence called DNS over HTTPS. TLS 1.2 is not actually required, but I'm kind of building this up here. How many people are familiar with DNS over HTTPS or DOH? Good, that's about half the room. And I would expect that many of you saw the announcement yesterday, which I was certainly not anticipating when I built this slide, that Mozilla actually enabled DNS over HTTPS by default for all of the users in the United States. Not the international theaters, but in the United States. Now, DNS over HTTPS is a bit of a contentious issue. On the one hand, it offers protection from snooping ISPs and various spoofing attacks. The DNS obviously is encrypted. This is a good thing. I think we can all agree that in many ways DNS was falling behind the times in terms of encryption and privacy. But on the other hand, DNS over HTTPS takes control away from the operating system and the user and puts it in the hands of the browser and the app. And Mozilla kind of dances around the argument a bit, but it does centralize DNS with a small number of unregulated providers, at least today. Maybe in the future, we'll have many, many, many DNS over HTTPS providers. But as of launch time, you know, Mozilla launched with two partners. Again, I'm going to try to avoid the issue of whether or not we should do this, but I'll say that as a network architect by trade, the domain name system is really one of the most successful distributed systems ever invented and has scaled from zero to, you know, billions upon billions of devices on the internet. Really unmatched scalability. So from that sense, I am a little sad to see such a centralized approach. On a practical note, DNS over HTTPS does bypass some enterprise policies. It can break split DNS if you don't take precautions not to. And it can potentially weaken the security posture because we can't perform some of those detections I mentioned earlier, such as, you know, reputation scores, some blocking, some blacklists. And then when we add TLS 1.3 into the mix, not only have we lost the host name with DNS over HTTPS, but we no longer see the server certificate from the perspective of a passive observer on the wire. The only thing remaining to us is really the IP address and the SNI. And maybe you know where I'm going with this. There's actually a draft standard. There's actually a draft standard, not approved yet, for SNI encryption. Now, SNI encryption, the way it works is a public key is published in the DNS record, and then using TLS channel binding in order to prevent replays, that SNI is actually encrypted to the server that you're communicating with. Now, in order to be effective, encrypted SNI not only requires encrypted DNS of some sort, otherwise, what's the point? We can just see the host name as it's being resolved. But it also requires a CDN. Without a CDN, we just see the IP address where it's going. Where I may be a little uncomfortable, again, is that this seems like more centralization of user tracking within a small number of providers, because there really aren't that many CDNs and public cloud providers out there that might offer services such as this. Now, how much privacy do DOH and encrypted SNI offer anyway? There was a recent University of Illinois study that I thought was fascinating, and it looked at what's called a page load fingerprint. So a page load fingerprint is the set of all the IP addresses contacted as the various resources within the page are loaded. And what they found when they looked at the Alexa top million websites is that with 95.7% efficacy, they could determine which website you're going to. So I think this certainly speaks to how much true privacy we're gaining. Now, I'll say somebody on the enterprise security side that this is not all that applicable to SecOps. I don't really anticipate a lot of vendor products that are going to be introduced to use page load fingerprints at the north-south corridor and figure out where people are going. But still, a fascinating study nonetheless. Much more practical is something like TLS fingerprinting. And there are various other forms of fingerprinting for both encrypted and unencrypted traffic. You know, there's HTTP fingerprints. There's hash SSH fingerprints for fingerprinting SSH. But probably the best known fingerprints out there are JAW3 fingerprints. How many of you have heard of JAW3s? Fair number. So JAW3's fingerprints are actually named after three individuals who at the time were all working at Salesforce.com and all have the initials JA. So it's John Althaus, Jeff Atkinson, Josh Atkins. And they introduced this in 2017, and this was based on 2015 research by Lee Brotherston, which in turn was probably based on research by even Ristic at Qualys SSL Labs in 2009. But the idea is pretty simple. We concatenate a bunch of the fields in the client hello, and then we compute an MD5 across it. And what we find is that fingerprint provides a reasonably good fingerprint of what client initiated the SSL handshake. And by client, I mean it could be a browser like Google Chrome or Mozilla Firefox, but it could also be the actual SSL library that you're using, depending on the options that the application itself has specified. So usually we can try to pin this down to an application. To make it a little bit stronger, there's JAW3S, which includes the server-side hello. But the gotcha here is that the server hello actually depends on the options negotiated by the client hello. So the JAW3 plus JAW3S can only be pinned down to a conversation between a specific application and a specific server. It's not used to fingerprint servers in the general sense. But together, they can be a pretty effective form of fingerprinting. Now, in reality, I think the JAW3s are pretty susceptible to false positives. Abuse.ch publishes a public, open SSL blacklist. It includes about 70 or so of these JAW3s that are known to be associated with malware. Now, what we did is we built up our own collection of JAW3s based on the user agents that were accessing a public web property of ours, and we correlated the JAW3s in the SSL blacklist with ours, and that we found that about 25% of the blacklisted ones seemed to correspond to pretty legitimate clients. Chrome, Firefox, IE11. And in essence, in abuse.ch's defense, they made that pretty clear in the caution banner. They said that this has not been tested against known good traffic. Now, even if it had, I'm going to say that JAW3s are pretty easily evaded. If you have a sophisticated attacker or a sophisticated piece of malware, I think at this point they will take care to make their JAW3s look like something legitimate, like a browser. That said, there are plenty of unsophisticated attackers and unsophisticated malware out there, so it's still pretty good. Also worth mentioning is that there's a technique called that Akamai called cipher stunting, based on some behavior they saw in 2018, where something on the internet was randomizing the SSL client, the TLS client fingerprints, and creating literally billions of unique JAW3s. I have no idea why it was doing this. Maybe it was a bug, maybe just because. That seems like a noisy way of doing things rather than a stealthy way. But also worth pointing out that when there's a lot of noise here, these become less useful. At the end of the day, I think that the JAW3s themselves are a useful indicator, but only when paired with other suspicious behaviors. As a standalone indicator, I think they're probably a bit too trivial to evade. So what other analysis can we do of the encrypted traffic itself, maybe beyond just the fingerprints? One approach is traffic analysis. Traffic analysis to me means analyzing things like packet lengths and inter-arrival times and TCP turns and entropy. There are a lot of great features there within the traffic in order to analyze. And this allows us to do things like tracking the actual flow of data, how much data is moving in which direction. It allows us to detect interactivity. And with entropy tests, we can even identify encryption. So I built these two charts myself. One of them is a bulk data transfer. And the other one is interactive traffic that I did on an encrypted web shell to AWS. I'm guessing that everybody in the audience can tell which one is which. And of course, we can build automated analysis that can make these sorts of determinations as well. So traffic analysis totally works. It's very useful. Unfortunately, like so many technologies, I do think it's a bit overhyped in terms of just how much information we can get from it. If a lot of information were leaking, then, well, encryption wouldn't really be doing what encryption is supposed to do. So there's some good information here. Fun fact, Tor actually includes pluggable transports like OBFS4, which includes random padding and packet splitting to resist analysis like this. Now, they're not going to include a whole bunch of noisy data, but it does make it more resistant to this, and I think that's pretty cool, and kudos to the Tor developers for always thinking about stuff a step ahead. Probably one of the most well-known commercial offerings in this area is Cisco's encrypted traffic analysis. And they've written blogs and white papers talking about their approach. And Cisco encrypted traffic analysis looks at a set of four or so types of features, including what they call the IDP, that's the initial data packet, the SPLT, which is the sequence of packet lengths and times, the byte distribution, and then what they call TLS-specific features, which I believe to be things like the certificate and the fingerprint of the options that you see in the client hello. And then what Cisco does is they'll actually detonate malware and try to train models based on what it looks like. And here's an image from their blog that shows the difference between a Google search and a particular piece of malware. And they claim that over 70% of malware uses encryption. I think this is an interesting approach, certainly. But it only works with known bad. You have to detonate an awful lot of malware. And I guess I'm going to say that from my view, it seems pretty fragile. Pretty easy to evade, like most signature-based approaches. I think that nowadays, signature-based approaches seem like a 1990s or early 2000s approach to malware. Malware has become polymorphic. There are various kits to assemble malware where you can change some of these signatures pretty easily, and now it would be a new piece of malware that you would have to train the model on. So it seems like a bit of a fragile approach, but still kind of interesting in the face of encryption. Speaking of which, while fingerprints and traffic analysis is good, plain text is always better. At the end of the day, there are TTPs that can only be detected when we have visibility into the actual decrypted traffic. We need to see URLs, we need to see query strings, we need to see user agents, we need to see login attempts, we need to see payload. And when it comes to forensics, storing really big piles of encrypted traffic is relatively useless. You might as well just be storing the packet headers. So lots of TTPs on the server side, lots of things on the client side that we want to employ that we can only do if we see the plain text. However, modern ciphers support the perfect forward secrecy or PFS property. What this means is that the session keys are ephemeral and they can't be derived from the long-term private key. So RSA shown on the left does not have perfect forward secrecy. If you have the RSA private key, you can decrypt all of the traffic that was ever sent. If you recorded that traffic and you get your hands on the RSA private key later, you can decrypt all of the traffic that was ever sent. Modern cipher suites, typically ones that involve some sort of Diffie-Hellman, ephemeral Diffie-Hellman, you know, or elliptic curve ephemeral Diffie-Hellman type of key exchange, do support perfect forward secrecy because the key itself is mutually derived. So that data remains secure even if the long-term private key is compromised. These are great properties for security and privacy, but it definitely makes analysis more challenging. Now, I went back and I managed to pull up some data from SSL Pulse, which is Qualys SSL Labs' annual, well, not even annual, but their survey where they track 150,000 TLS-enabled websites. So I was able to go back to 2013, and this is a little hard to read because there's kind of used with modern browsers and used with most browsers, but at the end of the day, less than 5% of top sites would use PFS in 2013, and nowadays, over 80%. And what occurred in the intervening time? Well, that was, of course, the Edward Snowden disclosures. After 2013, with the Edward Snowden disclosures, there has really been a concerted and, I think, fairly unified effort to push out perfect forward secrecy everywhere. Perfect forward secrecy is not new with TLS 1.3. The only difference with TLS 1.3 is that it mandates it. So as TLS 1.3 is fully adopted, this number will go to 100%. Now, with all of this perfect forward secrecy, how can we decrypt the traffic? Probably the most common approach is to employ some sort of, you know, SSL TLS interception. This is often called break and inspect, and it's performed typically at your next generation firewall or some sort of secure web proxy that you have in place. And this is really the preferred way to gain visibility into north-south traffic. It's great for local users and BYOD, you know, bring your own devices, in an enterprise environment that you control. That's the important thing. Now, the challenge with break and inspect, there's really a couple. First, there are implementation issues that can actually weaken your security posture. And by implementation issues, I mean that this, right here I called it man in the middle or monster in the middle proxy, it doesn't often do as good of a job acting as a client as a modern browser would. So what that means is it might not handle things properly like certificate expiration, revocation, you know, OCSP stapling, certificate transparency and the expect CT headers, you know, strict transport security, HSTS. There was a study done a couple years ago that actually gave pretty poor to even failing grades to a lot of these, you know, monster in the middle proxies in terms of their implementation of these things and how they might weaken your security. I'm optimistic that we're doing a little better in 2020. I have not seen a modern refresh of that survey, but I'm going to offer you some tools to do it yourself. Another big challenge with the break and inspect approach, though, is that requires a local certificate authority so that it can reissue certificates dynamically and on demand in order to perform the decryption. And with a local certificate authority, with that sort of power comes great responsibility, because you need to take great care to secure that private key. If that gets out there, then that's a problem. And of course, this sort of approach can break mutual TLS, and your client certificates are simply not supported in a model like this. They're not super common, but part of the protocol, and any deployment that breaks part of the protocol, I think, is a little bit problematic. One other thing worth mentioning is that the break and inspect proxies do often offer a decrypted feed for analysis of the traffic, so that if you want to employ an additional system for, you know, network detection or network analysis, you can often do so here. But since the data is decrypted and then kind of rewrapped or re-encapsulated, you're kind of looking at fake packets in that they don't necessarily have all of the same timing characteristics and length characteristics that you might have seen in the raw traffic feed. That said, you know, fake packets are better than no packets, so it is a worthwhile approach. A slightly different deployment model of this, but really the same idea, is what Gartner calls SASE, or Secure Access Service Edge. This is basically just a managed hosted offering of what I described. Often you see this in the form of a secure web gateway that is virtual or lives in the cloud and is managed and hosted by another vendor. This has all of the same, you know, it's kind of firewall as a service, or sometimes cloud access security brokers do this as well, CASB. This has all the same challenges and benefits as the local deployment, but it is a centralized hosted deployment. The only thing worth mentioning is different is that since you're basically creating a VPN tunnel to some sort of hosted secure web gateway, that means that your source IP address is typically obscured, just like it would be with a VPN. Not necessarily a bad thing, and then sometimes this is a good thing. I will mention that for all of the commercial solutions that I'm aware of, there is no decrypted feed for you to run your own analysis or kind of perform your own forensics or packet capture. So I would encourage anybody who cares about that to ask your vendor to introduce one. That's something that I think should happen in order to reach the equivalence that we see with the local and self-managed deployments. But, you know, these secure web gateways, they can perform URL filtering and content inspection and can block various services. For any of these approaches where you're performing some sort of break and inspect or some, you know, monster in the middle proxy, I would encourage you to go to this great site called badssl.com. And this is actually run by volunteers from Mozilla and Chrome. And this is a great way to see if your commercial or even open source offering, kind of what sort of security report card it's going to get. Is it lowering your security posture, or does it support expired certificates and, you know, expected certificate transparency and revocation and such? Definitely encourage everybody to test this for themselves. Now, Cloudflare has a dashboard on their site called Malcolm, and they run some fingerprinting tricks to basically determine, correlate that with the user agent, and try to determine how much of the client traffic is being intercepted with break and inspect. And you can see that the trend as of, you know, when I finish these slides is well over 20%, which is just an enormous number. That earlier study that I talked about in 2017 reported about 10.9%. So either there's some sort of selection bias and Cloudflare's traffic is more intercepted than the rest of the traffic and the internet at large, or we've seen a massive jump in this sort of interception. And this has actually gotten so bad to the point where the NSA issued an advisory in November warning about TLS interception, and really the same sorts of challenges that I just described in terms of potentially lowering your security posture. As alarming a trend as this is, because I think SSL interception in many ways is, you know, the most drastic approach where you're really opening every single letter and reading it, there are no real solutions in sight. There have been a number of various proposals, ETLS and enterprise TLS, data center use of static Diffie-Hellman. There have been a couple of proposals like multi-context TLS and middle box TLS. Most of these are academic papers and don't really have any clear path to adoption and not a lot of momentum behind them. And then the IETF's official response was really something along the lines of, don't call it TLS because it's not. So no real solution on the horizon. I do want to point out that a different deployment model for local services that you control. And this model I'm going to call termination and re-encryption. And this is different than break and inspect because there's no local certificate authority, no concerns about revoked or malicious certificates. This is really just an extension of the application that you control. And often that, in this case, the middle box is a load balancer or an application delivery controller or a reverse proxy, you know, a web application firewall, and even a service mesh. I'm going to use some of these terms interchangeably, and since I come from the application delivery controller world, I think ADC rolls off my tongue a little easier, but service mesh is probably the more modern term. Now, for network security, I love traffic mirroring because traffic mirroring works everywhere. It works in physical environments, it works in virtual environments, it works in cloud environments. It enables out-of-band analysis. It's great for the east-west corridor, great to deploy in campus environments, BYOD, IoT, any local services that you don't control, like commercial off-the-shelf software, COT software, and maybe a situation where the security team might not be able to exercise direct control over a DevOps team, but you can put traffic mirroring and network taps in place. And with the public cloud provider support, like AWS VPC traffic mirroring, you can actually put automated policies in place where whenever a new EC2 instance is spun up, it's automatically mirrored, which is great. The challenge, of course, is that out-of-band analysis really struggles with perfect forward secrecy. Without perfect forward secrecy, you could record traffic using Wireshark, load up a public key. You could do this with commercial solutions that maybe do real-time analysis, and with access to that, I'm sorry, with the access to the private key, it's able to decrypt and analyze the traffic, but with perfect forward secrecy, of course, you can't do that. One very temporary solution that I think is only a Band-Aid is what I'm going to call a TLS downgrade, where notice on the left side of your, you know, application delivery controller or proxy, you'll terminate TLS 1.3, and on the right side, while it's still acceptable, you can use TLS 1.2 with that RSA handshake. This is a real limited time offering. You know, TLS 1.2 is being phased out. I already listed a bunch of reasons why the RSA handshake might not be the best approach. So I think this is a temporary solution at best. Probably my favorite solution is what is I'm going to call a key forwarding solution. The key forwarding solution actually maintains the integrity of the end-to-end encryption, which is great. That means we don't run into any of those issues around, you know, expired or revoked certificates or, you know, lack of certificate transparency and such. It also means that we're analyzing the real packets. We're not looking at a decrypted feed. We're analyzing the real packets and decrypting it. So we have access to all of the timing information, all of the framing, everything that we need for traffic analysis. What it does mean is that either we have to deploy a lightweight agent at one of the endpoints that we control, and this lightweight agent basically intercepts the handshake, grabs the session key only, and then shares that with a monitoring device over a secure channel, hopefully a channel with perfect forward secrecy itself. And we can do this at some natural choke points like the load balancer, the application delivery controller, you know, the proxy, the service mesh. And some of them out there do support some form of session key logging where that's maybe even already built in, so we don't have to deploy an agent. When supported, this is absolutely a great approach and facilitates all of the real-time analysis and forensics and network-level detection that enterprise environments want to employ to ensure that their environments are secure. So in terms of some recommended next steps, I'm going to recommend that while DOH is great for home environments and personal use, if you're managing an enterprise environment, I would recommend configuring some enterprise policy or using Firefox's canary domain to turn that off. They have a special domain. They actually have a couple of them. There's a special one called use-application-dns.net that if it resolves, Firefox will use your local resolver and won't use DOH, which is great. I also recommend that if you're interested in that north-south traffic for, you know, user traffic or BYOD, I would recommend doing the SSL interception, the break and inspect. Maybe even better to have strong network segmentation so that you don't need to. But if you don't have that, doing this is better than nothing. And certainly I recommend session key forwarding for local services. And these are local services that you can control, and ask your vendor for support if that does not exist. Now, one of the questions that we get asked probably the most when I talk about session key forwarding is, does that actually scale in real world environments? I don't want to give away the answer, which is yes, but I'm going to invite my co-speaker, Josh Northrup, up on stage and talk to us about a real world deployment.
Thank you, Jesse.
Here you go, Josh.
All right, thanks, Jess. Hitting the wrong button here. Here we go. All right. So I work for Fiserv, and to give you guys a little idea about what Fiserv does, if anyone in this room has made an electronic payment today with their bank, or you did a personal payment, there's an 80%+ chance you went through a Fiserv product and data center. Give you just some rough stats, right? There's 44,000 employees, roughly, $17.5 billion annual revenue, and, you know, part of the Fortune 500. So, you know, what does decryption give us, and why is it important, right? So logging is not always up to par, especially open source or vendor-provided libraries. So being able to decrypt the network is really important to give you that holistic view. And, you know, one thing we use at work a lot is the network is the truth. And like Jesse touched on, it's very hard to hide in the network. So when you're looking at monitoring your environment, you kind of want to layer in those three things Jesse talked about. And being able to do it with the network is very important. You know, just for hardening your attack surfaces, right? Is someone enumerating your environment? What APIs are being accessed? How are they interacting with them? What is the user behavior of those? What's the trends that you want to look for? And of course, we're at a security conference, so where would be without talking about the CIA triad, right? So just general availability and security improvements. So, you know, why are we pushing the PFS, right? Why are we trying to put this in? You know, with newer standards and regulations out to protect the consumer information, and consumers becoming smarter, right? They want to know where their information's going, they want to know how you're using it, they want to trust you, right? So we want to protect that. In my experience, you know, we're starting to encrypt much deeper into the infrastructure, where before it'd be maybe just the ingress, egress of your data centers, and that'd be where your encryption would kind of start and end. Now we're starting to see it go, you know, not into your DMZ, but into your protected, up to the databases, right? So by doing that, your visibility goes down. And especially with TLS 1.3 that's using Diffie-Hellman, you no longer can use that public-private key to decrypt it. You need to be able to get those pre-shared session keys. So for the past couple of years, we worked with Jesse and the ExtraHop team, and we helped them to develop a solution for decrypting PFS. So they came up with a pretty good solution, in my opinion. There's about 3,000 session forwarding agents that we've deployed today. It's probably more like 3,500 today. We made this slide a couple months ago. We're deploying them every week, sometimes daily. On top of that, we got around 6,000 PFS sessions per second. This is just PFS sessions that have been decrypted. Doesn't include RSA, cipher suites, or any of that stuff, right? So we have by no means gotten everything. Right? We got something like 60 data centers, right? So we haven't gotten everything yet, but the goal is to get there. It says HTTPS and more up here, so we're not targeting just our HTTP traffic, right? You name your layer 7 protocol with SSL, that's what we wanted to be able to decrypt and monitor. So your LDAP, your TDS, right? You name it, if it has SSL, we want to see into it. And this is going to be a forever effort, right? And we knew this going into it. So all of our agents get deployed via automation. And we're starting to move this into our CI/CD pipelines, more buzzwords for you. And that way, any new remote endpoints, or any endpoints for that matter that we deploy, we're gonna have that same level of visibility. So just some next steps, right? You know, this is all, you know, my opinion, right? But, you know, we as an industry need to start preparing. There's a lot of things that are still a little outdated, right? So I got a question for you kind of to think about. You know, who's still using outdated standards like SSLv3? I wouldn't raise your hand for that, but, you know, just something to think about, right? There's still a lot of things out there that are really behind the curve today. Or your legacy systems. There's some systems that can't support TLS 1.3 today, which is fair, it's new, but they can't even support TLS 1.2. So we got a lot of work to be able to get all those up to par. And once we do, we need to be able to monitor that stuff correctly too. You know, TLS 1.3 and really encryption in general, it's not gonna be a silver bullet. It's not really enough to say that I'm encrypting everything all the way through my data center, that's enough, right? It's a must-have, you need to encrypt everything, but we also need to have a view into that data and into those transactions, right? You can't secure what you can't see, right? Which is a little backwards of encryption, but we wanna be able to stop attackers from seeing our stuff. We don't want them to man the middle, but I also wanna see what my products are doing and how you're interacting with them. So that way, if you're in that encrypted tunnel and I just said, yeah, that's good enough, now I don't know what you're doing, right? But if I'm decrypting it, I know the behavior, I know how you're interacting with it. Are you being a good citizen, bad citizen, right? All those type of things that we need to know about our products. So again, right, so visibility into third-party services. In my experience, this is one of the least monitored and logged areas of product integrations. You know, how many of your developers are really good at logging stuff, right? Some are. Not all of them. So they'll write great logging for their stuff, but then you might only get, hey, I got a 200 back from Google or whatever your microservices that you're interacting with. So by being able to decrypt not only your stuff, but every other thing you're interacting with, you now have the ability to take that macro view and say, this is how my application is interacting. Am I secure with these integration points? Are they secure coming into me? And am I doing the right thing with it? With GDPR and all these, you know, fancy regulations coming our way, it's just gonna get more and more information we need to have on our information leaving our data centers, right? So by watching the network, we can make sure that we know where everything's going, how it got there, and where it went. So for the past, you know, couple years, we've worked with ExtraHop on this decryption and PFS venture, right? And we finally got it to a good place where we're starting to go down this road and getting it to where we can monitor our environment properly. In my opinion, right, PFS decryption is kind of a must-have. You don't want to have that gaping hole in your monitoring and security posture. You want to make sure that you're actually able to see this stuff. So with that, I want to thank you guys for coming to the discussion. I'm going to lead into questions if you guys have any. Invite Jesse back on stage.
All right. Always hard to be the first question.
Kudos.
So you're, let me try to repeat the question, see if I captured it. What I hear you saying is that you have a monster in the middle proxy that's performing the break-in inspect, and you're saying what is the trend? Is that kind of the best practice? Unfortunately, that is the trend. More and more organizations are deploying these, and some of them are deploying them in a self-managed fashion, and some of them are deploying them in a hosted fashion where, you know, somebody else hosts the SSL TLS break-in inspect, but we're seeing more and more and more of that occurring. On a personal note, I think that's bad. I think it's bad for the world because it's certainly bad for personal privacy. As I said, we're opening up every letter and we're reading it, and we're starting to lose, it's becoming harder and harder to be selective about which letters are opened and which ones aren't. But from an enterprise security perspective, unless you have perfect network segmentation where your users are nowhere near your applications and you can block everything off with a proxy, then you're going to want some visibility into your user traffic, your BYOD traffic. And for that north-south corridor, that's the way to do it. So I think the other approach, and if I paint a picture for what the future might look like, you know, most enterprises might look eventually like, you know, Google's Beyond Core, where user traffic is completely segmented away from application traffic and everything goes through a proxy. But until that world arrives, I think we're going to see more and more break and inspect. Does that answer the question? Can we get the microphones turned on? Is there anything we can do there? Yeah.
Still a future for?
That's a great question. And the question is, what's the future of network traffic analysis as people are working more and more from home? And this is where I want to clarify that I believe that the real power of network traffic analysis is for the applications that you are building and providing and supporting. So if you're an ISV, an independent software vendor, and you're building some sort of application, and maybe it's hosted like in a SaaS environment, or maybe it's an application that you're using internally and you're responsible for, that's the environment that you need to secure. Those are your critical assets. And in that situation, it doesn't matter where the users are coming from. The users could be coming from a VPN, they could be on-prem, hopefully in a different segmented part of your network. They could be going through a reverse proxy. It doesn't matter. The area where you should employ network traffic analysis is to secure that environment. So, you know, for all of the applications that we run, we of course use network traffic analysis, and in many cases those are cloud environments where we want to inspect all of that traffic in order to detect suspicious behaviors and potential threats. We know exactly what the dependencies should be. We know exactly who should be talking to what. But if all of a sudden something in our cloud environment, which just kind of naturally feels a little bit opaque, starts exfiltrating data off to a different site or a different part of the environment, or maybe starts opening up interactive shells or anything that it shouldn't really be doing, we want to know about it. And that has nothing to do with user traffic. I think the future of user traffic will be, you know, network traffic analysis will be limited to campus environments and will be limited to essentially VPN concentrators, whether those are VPN concentrators that you run on-prem or essentially hosted VPNs like the more of the SASE model. Josh, anything to add to that?
No, I thought that was great.
Thanks.
Yeah, that was great. We're getting the...
We got the stop message. So that is the big red stop message. Thank you very much. And Josh and I will hang out for some more.